Homelessness Advisory Committee special meeting for Thursday, February 16th, 2023. The time is 7 p.m. At this time, Madam Clerk, may we get a roll call, please?
Councilmember Bedoya?
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Davis?
Present. In accordance with the California Department of Public Health guidelines, universal masking indoors is recommended for all persons regardless of vaccination status. Members of the public can participate in tonight's meeting remotely by visiting cityoftracyevents.webex.com and using the information that's on the screen. Under public comment, please raise your hand to speak by clicking on the hand icon on the participants panel to the right of your screen. To join via phone, you can dial the number that's on the phone in the screen and the password. Press star 3 to raise the hand icon to speak on an item. At this time, we're going to move on to, it should be public comment. Madam Clerk, it should be public comment, although it's not here. Okay, we're gonna move on to public comment. Does anybody in the audience wish to make a comment on anything that's not on tonight's agenda? Okay, seeing none in the chamber, we'll move on to WebEx. Madam Clerk, is there anyone on WebEx?
None on WebEx.
Okay, at this time, we'll close public comment and move on to the consent calendar. All right, can we get a motion to adopt the consent calendar?
Move to adopt consent.
All right, there's been a motion to adopt the consent calendar, and I second. All in favor? Well, do you want an aye or a roll call? Okay, aye. Yes. At this time, does anybody wish to pull an item from the consent calendar? Seeing none in the chambers, what about on WebEx, Madam Clerk?
None on WebEx.
Okay. All right, at this time, we're going to move on to the regular agenda item. Item 3A, Tracy Homeless Advisory Committee receive an informational report regarding the implementation of the City Council strategic plan to end and prevent homelessness and the most recent emergency interim shelter activities. May I have a staff report, please?
Good evening. Virginia Carney, Homeless Services Manager, City of Tracy. And good evening, Mayor Pro Tem and Councilmember Bedoya and the public. I will be giving tonight's update on 3A. Can I have the PowerPoint, please? Thank you. So we have been sharing our timeline ongoing. So we're just gonna kinda do a brief overview of what we have done on our homeless initiatives. So in August, we reaffirmed the declaration, the emergency declaration to seek interim solutions. So we began contract negotiations in September. We had our first modular buildings placed out at the Arbor Avenue site at the end of September. We also had been awarded a grant at the end of September as well. And I will go into some more details on these as we further along in the presentation. So October, we discussed an overflow site. We had some different things come up in October. We discussed the procurement agreements. We reopened the bid for phase two above ground construction. In November, we had our professional service agreements and ratification of procurement and goods for the shelter site. And then the shelter opened on November 14th. We had our additional custom containers arrive at the end of December. In January, we entered into a contract for the warming center. And we are anticipating occupancy of the custom containers in the near future. So we have outlined our presentation tonight on our strategic plan goals. So goal one is increasing housing options in the City of Tracy. So this is just an overview. So we opened the shelter November 14th. We finished our park to shelter transition plan December 5th. And what I mean by that is the shelter was full December 5th, and it has remained at capacity since then. Since opening the shelter, we have removed 76 tents from the parks. We have cleared 109 tons of debris. 76 people and 18 pets have been housed, and our capacity remains full due to the waiting list. So here is a bird's eye view of our interim shelter site. So we wanted to provide that to you. And then most recently, the expansion of our interim shelter site with the arrival of our custom containers. And then we wanted to give an update, a specific update on the expansion of the shelter site, which occurred December 29th. And the arrival of the addition custom containers, which will add 39 more beds to the site. There are 8 containers on the site. This includes 1 container for those with ADA requirements. During the early part of January, the inspection of the custom containers was delayed due to severe weather, storms, and a local emergency. So upon full inspection, city staff identified several deficiencies to California Building Code. 37 of the 39 units took on water during the storms and have water damage. We do have a cooperative vendor working on repairs. At this time, we do not have a timeline for completion of repairs for occupancy. So here is some of the damage. So as you can see, there's some water pooling on the window. There's some peeling of paint. there's some nails that were poking out, some paint marks on the doors. There's been some buildup of mold, some obviously more water damage, paint bubbling. Some more water damage. And we'll move on to our provider updates. So we wanted just to give an overview. This is just a chart we put together in regards to our providers. So I'll begin with CityNet. CityNet is our shelter operator. CityNet processed 76 individuals into shelter since November 14th. 36 men and 40 women. A total of 18 pets have been served. CityNet provided a range of services. These services included referrals to Social Security cards, employment assistance, ID cards, mental health and substance use referrals. In addition, 4 individuals exited the shelter with a housing destination. The shelter has remained at or near capacity since the transition plan was completed. However, occupancy can fluctuate daily. When open beds become available, CityNet informs both TCCC and Familiar Faces that the shelter is ready for new intakes. As of February 2nd, the shelter has 47 individuals and 8 pets. There are an additional 37 individuals on the waiting list who have already been processed and are awaiting an open bed. Staff is working with all partners to formalize the intake and exit procedures. Some limitations to daily intake process are the number of new clients the shelter can process in one day. One such limitation is the time required to fully transition the individual and their belongings into the shelter. Another example is the safety and personnel assessment process required prior to entry. We'll move on to Tracy Community Connection Center. Tracy Community Connection Center processed 75 unique individuals through their Navigation Center for shelter intake. 18 pets were also processed for shelter entry through the Navigation Center. There have been an additional 22 individuals who have been able to find alternate housing through the Navigation Center, pre-shelter and intake and referral services. So now I'm just going to go over this, this chart. Because we wanted to let you know what clients we have in shelter, the number of contacts. We also have our familiar faces, our Tracy PD outreach team that has become acclimated to this space. They onboarded it in November, so they've been working alongside our 2 teams. So we have 47 clients in shelter. Again, this is a few weeks old. This was, this had to go through our internal process, so there are updates as of today. But number of contacts, clients refusing to go into shelter, we have negative exits. So we wanted to kind of bring that up. So negative exits mean there was some kind of behavior problem. They were out too many nights. There were some issues, outside of, normal policies and procedures or rules. So that would be considered a negative exit. A positive exit is they went into another housing destination. Just to clarify that. We also have some of our warming center numbers on here as well. We wanted to bring out our family reunifications. We know that you've asked about that in prior meetings. Referrals to other housing. CityNet, as I just shared, had 4. As I also shared, Tracy CCC had 22. Familiar Faces had an additional 6, and we'll go into that when I update regarding that team. So our unique totals are at the bottom. Our total unsheltered encampments, we meet regularly with our police department, our outreach partners, our shelter staff. So we've identified there's 3 problem areas in the city. Our El Pescadero Park, our detention basin 4, and Placencia Fields. So we've estimated that there are 60 additional unsheltered individuals at 3 different encampments. Okay, so our budget update, grant update. I'm going to bounce around a little bit on this. So our reappropriations of the ARPA funding was, here we go. Our TEF update. Let me just get there. So on November 1st, 2022, City Council approved an appropriations of $2.6 million from ARPA, amending the fiscal year 22-23 operating budget to fund professional service agreements to provide operation services for the interim shelter. On December 6, 2022, City Council approved an appropriation of $470,000 from the general fund, amending the fiscal year 22-23 operating budget to fund improvements to the interim shelter site. And then I will go over this budget. So this is... Okay. Sorry, you guys. Okay, the capital improvement project for the sprung structure and final site improvements have approximately $7 million available for commitment, including a $3 million grant from Congressman Harder. Based on bids received, the estimated cost for completion of the entire site is between $10 and $11 million. The current bids for the sprung structure and site improvements have expired. Engineering is evaluating the project for possible reduction in costs. The city has not been able to secure grants related to the total cost of the project. Staff has identified a new fuel vendor for the temporary generators, resulting in an approximate 30% reduction in costs. Staff is working closely with contacts at PG&E, and they fully understand that this project is one of the highest priority projects of the City of Tracy. There are 2 applications currently pending for a new PG&E connection. The city's application for a permanent connection submitted previously when construction bids went out remains in the queue with PG&E. The city's application for a temporary connection was accepted on January 24th, 2023, in anticipation of a temporary PG&E connection. Engineering staff is working to procure a temporary switchgear and the design for installation at the site. And here we just have a breakdown of our different grants and what funding has gone, what expenses have gone into those. This is a breakdown. We have our $3 million federal funding in there at the bottom, and then our 7.6 that remains in the balance. And then for my grant update, so our Homeless Housing Assistance and Prevention, otherwise known as HAP program updates, round 2 has awarded the City of Tracy as the subrecipient to receive funds in the amount of $414,042. The subrecipient agreement was executed by the City of Tracy on November 9th, 2022. Two more rounds of HAP funding are still to come, round 3 and 4. And since posting this, the city submitted their application for round 3 on January 5th in the amount of $1.4 million for shelter operations, service coordination, and outreach. Further details on round 4 have not been released. And this was the first year that the city was able to apply for operations through HAP. The city also applied to receive a City of Tracy CDBG allocation in the amount of $450,000 to support construction costs for the ancillary buildings. We just found out that was awarded, though it was at $338,000. And that is yet to go to council, but we just found out we were awarded. The city has prepared the submittal for reimbursement from the county's $3.6 million grant for initial construction costs. So that was the original ARPA allocation for the permanent site. So we are submitting reimbursement for that. And then the city, as I just shared, received notification of the award of $3 million grant from Congressman Harder for the construction of final work at the shelter. And the city is currently awaiting correspondence from San Joaquin County to move forward with an additional ask for unspent ARPA funding. This ask could range from $3 to $7 million. We also received notification of the award of the $1.2 million allocation from the Health Plan of San Joaquin. That will also go to council in the next few weeks. And then in addition to the above applications and allocations, the city is currently applying to the state of California for the Encampment Resolution Fund. Staff anticipates that this will be in the amount of, and I have a correction to this, I wrote $3 million, but we've been working on this diligently, and now our ask is up to $5 million. We are working, so Tracy Police Department, the Homeless Services Division, and Towns and Public Affairs are working on the submission of this application. We will be submitting it by February 28th. And then moving on to the budget. So we have up here some of the funding allocations, what they've been spent on, our modulars, our custom containers, our service provider contracts, staffing, operating subsidies, the fuel, what we've received, what's been expended. And then we have a balance of $397,884. And that is the Homeless Services Division operating budget. And we just wanted to keep this up for everybody. So this is our revised project site plan. So these are our phases. We are still referencing these. So I just wanted to leave this up there for everybody. And again, this slide as well. Our housing option, anticipated shelter capacity by the end of 2023. This has not changed. This is still our goal. And then goal 2. Increase access to coordinated support services for people experiencing homelessness. And thank you all for getting through that first goal with me. I know that was a lot to cover. Okay, so we have our coordinated efforts, continuum of care update, professional services contracts awarded, our park cleanups, and then an update on our transit services to and from the shelter site. So our coordinated efforts between city departments continue, including Public Works, South County Fire, Tracy Police Department, and Code Enforcement to proactively address issues related to homelessness and providing biweekly park cleanups. These cleanups also serve as an opportunity to educate the homeless population on available resources in the community and the park to shelter transition plan. The Tracy Police Department has deployed their Familiar Faces team, who is working closely with the homeless services providers conducting outreach and engagement to our unsheltered population within the city. The continued biweekly deployment of Operation Helping Hands is continuing and is very successful. This team includes the Homeless Services Division, Tracy Police Department, resource officers, San Joaquin County Behavioral Health Services, CareLink, Whole Person Care, community medical centers, the Salvation Army, and other local nonprofits. Our continuum of care update, the city's homeless services manager attended her first COC meeting on January 12th, 2023. Active participation on the COC board will ensure that the City of Tracy's voice is heard and stays relevant to the changing climate. This will also give the city the opportunity to be on the front line of all regional and county concerns regarding homelessness initiatives. The Homeless Services Manager will also be seeking an appointment on the COC Housing Subcommittee. Professional services contracts awarded. The city partnered with Tracy Community Connection Center to open a temporary warming center at the Tracy Sports Complex on January 2nd, 2023. The hours are 7 p.m. to 7 a.m. However, some extended hours have been provided depending on weather conditions of the day. Some programs and sports rentals were relocated to other city facilities as needed, and no interruptions in sports field rentals occurred. The warming center has had 35 attendees with an average of 6 per night as of 1/19/23. Staff amended policy to require pets to be crated while at the warming center. Service animals are allowed in the warming center if they remain on an owner-controlled leash. The city has extended the warming center through the month of February. Weather forecasts for the beginning of February reported freezing temperatures and additional rain. The estimated cost for 2 months is $40,000. Park cleanup. Areas of El Pescadero being fenced off as encampments are cleared as a precautionary public health safety measure to allow the city the opportunity to inspect those areas for hazards, evaluate the safety and condition of the landscaping, and prepare for scheduled maintenance like tree trimming. City's future plans for El Pescadero Park include the construction of the new multi-generational gymnasium center. During the early portion of January, Tracy Community Connection Center, Familiar Faces, and Code Enforcement dedicated resources to helping the unsheltered to move to less flooded areas of the parks. As mentioned above, Tracy CCC provided transportation to and from the warming center with pickups at El Pescadero Park, Detention Basin 4, and Placencia Park. So we have totals for the month. I think some of these totals were already, but we have some updates, our December totals. So 0 citations, 10 hazard tent site removals, and 5 pickups for approximately 18 tons. Totals for the month of January, 0 sites, 16 hazard tent site removals, and 18.35 tons of debris removed. To date, no citations have been issued to any park residents for not accepting a bed at the shelter site. And then an update on our transit services to and from the shelter site. Our transit manager did not have any updates to report. He said everything's going really well. There's been no updates. It's moving really. Everybody's, you know, there's no additional numbers to report from last month. So last month's update is the same for this month, that they are utilizing the bus routes. There's 4 loops, and it's successful. So goal 3, develop action plans for engaging with people experiencing homelessness. Tracy Police Department's homeless outreach coordinators started with the city of Tracy on November 21st. Funding through the Familiar Faces grant, these staff will receive training on city operations to include police operations, municipal code standards, crisis intervention, behavioral health services. The Familiar Faces team immediately began outreach and training, behavioral health threat assessment and Narcan training, assisting with shelter intake, organizing and networking with nonprofits and religious groups to identify gaps and solutions, reunification, Habitat for Humanity-like efforts, and continue to assess the current resources and identify gaps and needs. Patrol teams have received briefing for how to best utilize the Familiar Faces team and have begun requesting Familiar Faces when an outreach-based solution is required on a patrol call for service. The Familiar Faces program will serve as an initial call, triage level, and follow-up response. The team will provide referrals to Tracy PD, Tracy Community Connection Center, Behavioral Health Services, and/or District Attorney's Office. The team will also offer transportation services to individuals in need of reunification to home, shelter, or urgent care services. Outreach team spent most of their time during our recent storm surge assessing the high flood areas to make sure individuals were given resources and support if needing to relocate within our city parks. And this is our flow chart. I think we've shared this previously. We just wanted to reiterate our flow chart with our different teams. Familiar Faces responding to PD calls for service related to unsheltered homeless individuals, identification, triage, and transport. Tracy Community Connection Center is our pre-shelter services, street outreach and engagement, client needs assessment, intake referrals to programs and or to the shelter site, our emergency shelter operations, CityNet, daily care and program oversight of clients, maintenance of the facility and site, and then our last but not least, our housing, which is something that we are working on diligently, transitional and permanent housing and permanent supportive housing options. And our goal 4, enact specific strategies for vulnerable subpopulations experiencing homelessness. So the city's transition plan has focused on our most vulnerable residents who are residing in city encampments. This would include but not limited to transitional aged youth, veterans, the LGBTQ community, victims of crime, and those with behavioral health needs. City staff is currently working with behavioral health services to solidify additional resources to come alongside our shelter project. And just an update on that, we do have them actually at the shelter site. So they are there on Wednesdays. Our PD team is there on Wednesdays. We also actually had a wonderful productive meeting with their executive team. So we're working on some collaboration for our Tracy Clinic to have some substance use disorder hours so we can get people assessed here in Tracy instead of having to go out to county for services. So that happened yesterday. We had a very productive meeting. So we're really excited about that. The county outreach teams, which include behavioral health and whole person care, have provided additional support during our transition plan. Having the interim shelter site in operation gives local providers and staff at the facility the opportunity to engage with individuals daily to ensure the appropriate connections to resources. County mental health and public health providers have been providing on-site support throughout the week. Case managers at the shelter site are providing on-site case management and focusing on our most vulnerable shelter residents. Our familiar faces and Tracy Community Connection Center teams are out in the community daily engaging with unique clients and assessing unsheltered individuals for entry into the shelter or referrals to other resources. Familiar faces engaged with 70 unique individuals through their outreach efforts. The team currently does not have anyone on their shelter waiting list. The current waiting list was exhausted on February 3rd. They are currently collaborating with Tracy Community Connection Center, who is monitoring the current city team wait list for shelter services. There is currently 10 documented unsheltered individuals that are on record refusing services. The team has been able to support family reunifications and other referrals. So we had an overview. We had one family reunification in December. We had 3 in January, which was a total of 6 people, and 1 in February. Of the 70 unduplicated clients, 35 were interested in the shelter and referred to Tracy Community Connection Center for intake. And we did want to outline that 11 of the clients were from special vulnerable populations, those impacted by HIV, domestic violence, and or were disabled. And then in addition, the city is in conversations with our managed care plans to provide support to subpopulations as we build in bed capacity over the coming months and year. And our fiscal impact, the update is provided as informational. The city funds homeless services through the general fund and various grants. Staff recommends that the Tracy Homeless Advisory Committee receive this informational report regarding the implementation of the City Council strategic plan to end and prevent homelessness and the most recent emergency interim shelter activities. And this concludes my report.
Thank you very much, Ms. Carney, for that very comprehensive staff report. I know that you and Ms. Schneider worked very diligently on getting all of that information. Before we go to public comment, Councilmember Doya, do you have any clarifying questions?
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. I have a few questions for staff. Is it better for me to give you all the questions now and then address them, or one by one? Okay. Well, I want to know if you could tell me a little bit more about the cause of the damage. What was it? A leak? Was it?
Actually, I can't speak to each individual. Most of it was leaks within the building. What caused that, whether it was from being in transit or how it was constructed, I couldn't speak to how the damage occurred. We also had a 100-year flood. More rain came at one time than ever before. So I think it was a combination of all of the above. every single container took on water, so there's certainly some concerns about that part of it and why we've asked for a California building inspector to be on site while they are being reconstructed.
Okay. I really like that we're, you know, calling a California licensed building inspector. Did we do this when we took receipt of the containers? Did we as a city or a third party inspect these containers to make sure that they were, you know, goods that we paid for?
So we have not accepted the containers. We are at the inspection point to begin with. They arrived on December 28th and 29th, and on December 31st, we had our 100-year flood rain come in. It took about 3 weeks where there were minor inspections occurring along the way, including a full electrical inspection that took place during those first 2 to 3 weeks of January. By the third week of January, we had the comprehensive what we call a punch list or list of deficiencies and began contacting the vendor, and the vendor has been responsive every time we've contacted them and is continuing to work. They've been out 3 times now to look at the site and going through that list of repairs with us.
Okay. Is it customary to be in the acceptance process for going on a month and a half now?
I would say probably not, but it's not uncommon. Even in our areas of regular construction, there's areas of town where we've taken over a year to accept a park in a new development, for example, because there could be outstanding items. This is new. I would not have expected this. We were expecting it to be about a month process from inspection, acceptance, and our final building permits. So we're certainly behind, as well as the amount of repairs are going to put us quite behind schedule. And we don't have that timeline as of today. We were hoping with today's inspection we would have a timeline, but we still do not.
Okay. And I hear what you just said, but is there any way to get either a rough estimate on a timeline of repair publicly today, even if it's a ballpark figure, or start talking about what replacement would look like?
We do believe in some of the custom containers, they will probably be a full gut and rebuild. If I were to surmise, not having any accurate accounts from the vendor, if it took us 6 to 8 weeks to build them, it could take possibly 6 to 8 weeks to repair them. However, I do not want to say that for any type of, I have nothing in writing, have nothing from them to make those assumptions. Just based on the amount of mold we're already seeing and some of the water damage, unfortunately, some of them will have to be completely gutted.
Okay. Whether it's reflecting on the past or jumping forward, I want to just ask a quick question about the sprung structure. The one that was originally planned for end of 2022 was delayed now for a year or more. Where are we in the process with RFPs or bids with the sprung structure? The one that is still phase 1 and 2, correct? Yes.
That's how we refer to them. Yes.
The 68 beds.
Phase one, which was all of the undergrounding, is wrapping up, and final acceptance of those improvements are taking place with construction management at this time. Phase two went out to bid in the summer, went out to bid again, and those bids were open in October. Unfortunately, at this time, they still continue to be outside the amount of funding we've had, is why we were pursuing grants with the county in the range from the $3 to $7 million. Currently, we are still short about 30% of the full construction. Engineering is currently working on those documents to see if there's anywhere else they can continue to improve the cost and estimates on those plans. One of their strategies is to look to take out individual and build for at least the minimum repair, improvements that need to happen at the site. For example, electrical, as we've talked about, the road improvement, putting in a parking lot, and putting in a sewer lift station. Those are the minimum to make the site complete that have to be done. And we're looking to be in the next 3 weeks to see if we can bid out those as individual projects as we wait and continue to apply for more grants until we can get to the sprung structure. Ms. Carney also indicated that one of the grants that she was just awarded was for the kitchen. So one of the grants that we just received is most of the funding for one of the auxiliary buildings. So we're almost kind of going from two directions. What's the minimum amount of improvements we need, and how many buildings can we buy going from the other direction? So we're constantly looking for that and continue to apply. We believe there's going to be another federal grant as well that we may be eligible for that we're starting to hear some rumblings about to see if we're eligible for, but that has not been released on the construction side. And so we continue to be very proactive and hope to secure the rest of the funding so we can complete the site.
Okay, and last question. It was towards the end of last year the fourth quarter of last year where we got an email and then it was made public later where the sprung structure was delayed because of a PG&E process. I've heard different perspectives that, you know, RFP could have been extended had it been caught. But by then, you know, it was brought to council and, you know, it had to be rejected. Where are we in any of the phases with PG&E? And I guess add to that question, anything else that might be perceived as a possibly avoidable delay?
There are two permits currently pending with PG&E. And per the staff report, you saw that we were waiting for one of those applications, which is the what we call the sprung structure or the permanent area. We actually got word this week that that application by PG&E has finally been accepted. However, the construction and actual purchase of the switchgear, as we know it from our conversations, was part of the bid documents that need to be rejected. It's a bundled. It couldn't be separated out and just work on that. So that's part of what I was just describing that engineering is currently doing. They're trying to now separate each of these into smaller bite-sized projects so we can still see progress on construction. We expect to have those documents in the next 2 to 3 weeks from engineering, and we'll know when we can go out to bid, and maybe we'll be able to get just the application done for the electrical. That is just for the sprung structure. For the original site designs, we refer to phase two, it also includes the sewer lift station. There is another one, and we heard it listed on the staff report as temporary. That's because it's referred to on what's phase three and four, or the modulars and the custom containers. The site actually now at full build out needs two different switch gears to electrify the entire site. And that's the area that we know of as being connected to the generators. We are working right now. We have an application, and they are working diligently with us and our partners. I heard even our partners with Serlin is helping us try and secure the equipment we need and trying to help us through the PG&E using their contacts. Councilmember Evans has also helped us with contacts he has from his background, helping us try and secure and move these applications along. And we hope to get that in the next couple of weeks. If that's the case, we'll go out and bid for that electrical and electrify the modulars and the custom containers through that particular switch gear. So there are two applications, two sites that need to be electrified on the full site. And our goal is between 90 to 120 days that we'll have an update and be off of the generators. That is the update as of Tuesday morning. Was in the staff report because we'd already printed, but as of Tuesday, that was our update from engineering.
Thank you, staff. That's all.
Thank you, Councilmember Bedoya. Thank you again, staff. I do have a few questions, and some are related to questions that Councilmember Bedoya asked. First of all, I want to thank you for being very transparent about some of the questions that are circulating in the community regarding the containers. You know, we see them sitting there, and they've been there for several weeks, and so the obvious question is, why aren't they occupied? And so I do think, you know, things happen, you know, and we wish that it could be different, but I really do appreciate the transparency and letting the public know that, you know, there was a storm and, you know, we saw significant damages and, you know, we're not able to occupy them in that way. But what I was a little bit discouraged by is that we don't have a timeline for when they're going to be repaired, and why is that?
Because they're still approving the punch list, meaning they're still going through agreeing on what the deficiencies are and agreeing on how to fix them. For example, the insulation is being discussed right now. If they do the insulation, is it a complete tear down of all the insulation, or is there anything that's reusable? So going through that is taking some time with the vendor and the construction contractor that they have on site, again, going through the California Building Inspector, who's also signing off on the work. So That's going to take us some time, and I can assure you they have the full list, and they met with us on Tuesday, and they met with us on Wednesday, and I was hopeful when I was writing the staff report that by Thursday I would hear something, but we're not expected to hear anything this week, so we're hoping next week. As soon as we get those timelines and there are something we can all agree on, I also don't know if there's going to be anything on the list that they may not agree with. At that point, we might have to go through some other discussions with them. Right now, I just want to emphasize they are being completely cooperative, trying to make repairs. They're actually even looking at other custom containers that they have put in the state of California, such as the County of Merced, and trying to use those as some of the benchmarks on how to make these improvements. So we've looked at their Arizona models. We've looked at their Merced models. I'm also working with the city attorney's office to make sure that I'm in compliance with everything that they feel we should be doing with building code as well. I've got some recommendations from her I'll be following up on. So working diligently to move this forward.
Thank you. I also want to acknowledge a lot of the things that the city of Tracy is doing right. I know this is a very sensitive subject for our community, and you know, it's been an extremely long process, at least for the couple of years that I've been here, and even as a resident prior to that, just watching the progression of how we as a council and as staff are trying to meet the needs of the unhoused population. So I do want to thank staff for all the work that you do. I do want to thank Tracy Police Department, Code Enforcement, and Public Works, Fire, and everybody, because it is a lot. Also, our community partners who do an incredible amount of work to help the unhoused community. With that being said, I do want to discuss, just as a clarifying question, and I'll go to public comment very shortly. You said that there were some limitations to getting people processed, and some of it has to do with background and making sure that people are vetted. And how can we improve that process and make it a little bit more efficient so that we can get people out of our parks and public spaces just safely, but a little bit more quickly?
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. Yeah, so we are meeting weekly as a team. So our Tracy Community Connections team, our CityNet team, we are working very diligently to assess any issues or gaps in getting people assessed and into the process. We have a waiting list, and the team is out in the community. So what we've come to know is that, you know, there's an exit, and then there's a process that starts, and sometimes it can take, you know, 24 to 48 hours to either clean up the room that the individual was in. There's a process for the individual to come from the park into the shelter. They have to go through, their belongings have to go through a process where they sit in a hot box to make sure they don't bring anything into the shelter site. There's a process with their belongings. Sometimes they have an excess of belongings, and so the team will have to figure out ways to work through downsizing their belongings. Sometimes that can take a couple of days. I can probably let maybe Lieutenant Contreras speak to that a little bit too, because they are clearing the tents when that comes up.
Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem, Councilmember Bedoya. Yeah, part of our efforts is also to be proactive with our residents who are in the parks, advising them of what the standards are for the shelter, letting them know that you cannot bring all of this property into the park itself, and just letting them be realistic with them in regards to what the expectations are. And not only that, but just being proactive, not just at El Pescadero, but all of our other neighborhood parks. For instance, today I had our Familiar Faces team drive by as many parks as they could to see if there's any tents in those locations. We do know that we have a heavy presence at El Pescadero, and with that, we do know that we're probably pushing people to other locations as well. So we want to make sure that we're addressing other locations throughout the city also. But all of it is just being proactive, communicating with TCCC, with CityNet. And the good thing is that we do have a strong communication presence now, which is really good for us, and just establishing the partnerships that we do have. In addition to, we've also extended our partnerships to Union Pacific Railroad and Caltrans, because we understand that some of the populations will start migrating to their properties. And as soon as we see it, we're on the phone with them to let them know what is occurring. And that's been, next time I'll show you some before and after photos regarding the work that they've done on their properties as well.
Thank you. And the other question that I had was regarding gaps in services. When we had our conversation, Ms. Carney and Ms. Snyder, that was one of the things that came up. Mental health services, substance abuse services, we know that those things are very limited within the city of Tracy. How are we building partnerships regionally, trans-regionally, across county lines, within the county as well? How are we building partnerships beyond behavioral health and I forget the other one that was mentioned, whole person? How are we building relationships beyond those two entities to get people the services that they need?
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. Yes, so I shared a little bit about it in my update, and we had a meeting with their executive team yesterday. We are also working with Modesto Police Department. They have a community response team, kind of like our Familiar Faces team. I've been in conversations with them, so we're working with them to figure out how they're navigating their space. So we are reaching out to, our surrounding cities and counties to see what they're doing, how they're responding, what their initiatives look like. We definitely have a lot of work to do in that space, especially, a lot of our work has been, getting the shelter up and running and getting our providers acclimated and working collectively here in Tracy. So that is something that we are doing. We are making progress in that space. And like I shared, we are working with the behavioral health team in the county to bring more services to South County out here, because we know that we are siloed in a lot of ways, especially we were talking about our different levels of mental health. So behavioral health services are, they call it moderate to severe. And unfortunately, a lot of our unsheltered fall in the mild to moderate and have a severe substance use disorder. So we were, asking them, how can we get more substance use services here in Tracy? And so that is something that we're looking at, that the Tracy Clinic could have a substance use disorder counselor walk-in hours for our unsheltered here in Tracy. But absolutely 100%, it's something that we are looking to. I do have contacts in Livermore. We have, like I said, Modesto, Stanislaus County, but we are definitely looking to other areas to join forces with, or find out how they are responding and what they are doing about their unsheltered in their own cities and counties.
Okay, thank you. And one of the things that you mentioned was vulnerable populations, mm-hmm. and we spoke about this in the November meeting about how we can connect with community partners who are already established, existing programs. And I mentioned Chest of Hope. Has the staff reached out to Chest of Hope? They have three transitional homes, and they also just opened an emergency shelter for victims of domestic violence and human trafficking. And they've been doing that for years. And so I'm wondering, has staff reached out, because I'm sure there's women, who have been affected by that. Have we reached out to them?
We have worked with Chest of Hope. In regards to some of the individuals who we do see out, possibly pre-homeless, I guess you could say, and using them as a resource to prevent an individual from actually becoming homeless. So we have worked with Chest of Hope.
Okay. And have any of our unhoused community members who have been affected by domestic violence, have they been referred to Chest of Hope and their housing programs?
There definitely are a resource, and I would say that we have not had, I don't believe we had any type of domestic violence-related, unsheltered, related incident occur where we had to transition someone from wherever they're at. That has not come up in regards to that they needed immediate shelter. Typically, it's a report, or we try to offer some type of a service to them, but nothing in regards to a a relocation. I don't know if that makes sense, but it's that situation of relocating them has not occurred.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Oh, well, we're going to go to public comment in just one moment, Mr.
It's
Paris.
It's not really public comment. As a service provider, you asked a question. Okay.
We're going to go to public comment in just a moment. Thank you for that, Officer Contreras. And the last thing that I wanted to ask was regarding cost savings, and that's probably not for you. But once we assess the damage to the modulars, are we going to have any type of financial responsibility for any of the repairs that are being done or being considered?
Thank you for the question, Mayor Pro Tem. As of right now, again, I have a very cooperative vendor. The only cost I am doing that the city has related to the custom containers is the same one I had with the modulars, is that there's a very specific type of lock our providers like to have that is a digital lock. And we go and we've made that purchase. Other than that, in the connections to electricity and water in our building permits, which is our responsibility regardless of the damage, we would have taken on. Those are costs that we have already planned for the custom containers. As of, again, this morning in our last talk with our vendor this afternoon, they are still taking full responsibility for the repairs.
Okay, thank you. At this time, we're going to go ahead and turn it over to public comment. And I definitely know that Mr. Paris had a public comment. Mr. Paris, would you like to come up?
A couple of things that I wanted to say is, first of all, it's good to see how far we've come. I mean, in May of 2020, they adopted a strategic homeless plan. And I remember when y'all both came to my office when we had our mini summit for homeless. And now we actually have put things in progress to where we have are dealing with people. A couple of things that I wanted to deal. You asked a couple of questions, like the transition, getting people in and out. At the University of Michigan, I studied subcultures and cultures, the effects that they have on populations, whether it be workforce or whether it be communities. And I also studied learned helplessness. And so if I can give you a little bit of my background, it'll help you to understand the issues that we're dealing with. Oscar T. Lewis said, by the time a person is exposed to a subculture for 6 or 7 years, that they absorb the basic attitudes, beliefs, and values of that subculture. And even if you bring them into a new culture, they'll respond to that new culture in the way that they were conditioned in the old culture, which means that when you pull people out of an environment, when they go into the new environment, they still respond the way that they were conditioned. Seligman and Myers were two social scientists, and they wanted to understand what happens when you put a person in a condition where they can't control the things that are happening to them. And so one of the things that they did is they did an experiment with dogs. They had three groups of dogs, and they were all trained to push a panel. And so once all groups were efficient at pushing the panels, one group they did nothing to, so we won't talk about that group. But they put them in cages. And inside of the cages was the same panels that the dogs were trained to push. And so when they pushed them inside the panels in the beginning, they gave them a treat. And so eventually what they did is they administered a shock to the dogs while they were in the panel. And so the first set of cages, the dogs were shocked. They pushed the panel, and then the shock turned off. They realized that they didn't get a treat, but by pushing the panel, it controlled the shock. In the second set of cages, the dogs were shocked. They pushed the panel. Nothing happened. And so eventually, the dogs in the first set of cages, you could actually measure how much time it took for them to turn the shock off. They would instantly turn it off. The dogs in the second set of cages where the panel didn't work eventually laid in a cage. They flinched, but they never tried to push the panel again. They accepted they accepted the shock as a part of their normal life. And then what they did is they took both sets of dogs out of the cages and they put them in a shutter box. The same pad under the bottom that shocked the dog exists, except this time there's no top. There's nothing constraining the animals within this cage. And what they discovered is the first set of dogs that were inside of the cages, when they were shocked, when they knew they had control of the shock, they jumped out of it. And then the second set, because there's a new environment, no one told them what to do in this new environment, but something, in, you know, they had learned that they had control of it, so they utilized it. The dogs that were in the second set of cages, even though they were in a new environment, escape was possible just by jumping out of the box. They laid there and accepted the shock as a normal part of their everyday life. They had learned to be helpless. Seligman and Meyer said that the only way that you can take that animal, that dog, and then they start dealing with it from the standpoint of people, that have learned to be helpless, is that they had to, you had to put them in the shuttle box and keep pulling them out until they realized that they could do it on their own. I had a guy ask me, he said, Bubba, when you have people that are chronically homeless, who are drug addicted, that are dealing with mental illness cases, how do you keep that cycle from going on? What can you give to that person to make them feel as though, I mean, what can you give to that person to bring them out of this chronic homeless stage? The one thing that we give them, and what you've been able to do through the programs that we have here, we give them hope. That one of the things we understood, like, is 139 people as of today were processed through the shelter. We went into the parks, we talked to them, they wanted to go into the shelter. And we've had, as of today, 86 clients actually went in. But we had a client go in yesterday, went out today. And so most people will look at that and say, wow, what's happening? But if you look at learned helplessness, and you look at the culture of poverty, that we have to sometimes keep keeping these people in and out until they adjust to the process. So the thing that that I feel about the whole process, that this has been 90 days. In 90 days, a city that has not had a city-sponsored shelter bed since 1878 has done it. You know, that we have done it. And we have things on the horizon that will allow us the opportunity to house more people. But the reality of it is that for the period of time, we're on pace. And you're right, one of the things that we do is, because we our responsibility is to do pre-shelter services. And we have put people in the Chest of Hope. We put, what's the place that we send them to over the a mountain, over the hill? The other domestic? Tri-Valley Hayden. We take some people, women. If we know of a woman that has been any type of trafficking or things bad, before we send them to a shelter, we process them through these different women's shelters. So we do. We process veterans. And so the answer to it is the city doesn't have to do some of these things. Like code enforcement doesn't have to make sure a woman or a person that's in an abusive situation is put into a shelter, because they've hired us, that as we process them through and we realize that this is one of the situations that they face, and we miss it sometimes, but we send them somewhere like the Chest of Hope to where we give them hope. So I say all of that is to say that you both were at the office when just this notion was just something we talked about, and that we have gotten to the point where it's real. And nothing that we're going to do is going to change the culture of poverty from existing. When we bring people into that shelter, just because we bring them, they're brought into a shelter, doesn't mean that they're going to respond in the way that we need to. And sometimes, just like Seligman and Myers realized when they had to pull that dog through, we do it. We put them in, they jump out, we put them in, jump, and hopefully we can give them some sense that eventually that they can be housed. And some of them we can't. But I say all of that is to say this, is that I am, as a person that from day one has never missed any issue that has dealt with homeless in the last 2.5 years, the one thing that's been for sure is that I've been at every single meeting that we've had. And I have always advocated on behalf of trying to figure out a way. When they come here and ask me what we're trying to do, we're trying to give the city their parks and their streets back. But we're doing it by providing humane services. And so the issues that you addressed as far as the women go and as far as the turnaround time, from what I've discovered, it's normal. And that part of it is because when a person, I mean, can you imagine a woman, she was in our office yesterday, she was so excited, she couldn't wait to be in the shelter, and then she left today. But if you didn't know the culture of poverty or learned helplessness, you would think that that something happened. So we are doing, you know, we're doing good work, that normal things are happening, that that eventually if we stay the course, we'll be able to give the city their free spaces back, because that is my goal. And we will be able to provide transitional housing, and we will make sure vulnerable populations, before they get to the shelter, are processed through and sent to places that we even went as far as this. We realized that people have mental health issues there. We had a grief counselor? We had a grief counselor come into our office, and we take people that have been into the shelter and around, and we bring them in our office and give them counseling with people who are experts in that. You can't do the whole population like that, but we're taking pieces of that population that we can, when they're in that box and they're getting shocked and they think they have no control, we pull them out, and then we pull them out, and we pull them out, and then we pull them out, and it's our hope that by keep doing that, eventually we will be able to emancipate a mass majority of the people who are experiencing homelessness. But for a city who had taken on this challenge in the last few years and are doing something, from a person that you know, my life is complete without homelessness. I mean, meaning that I've done a lot of stuff in my life to where I don't need this cause to define me. But what I'm saying to you is that this cause...
Mr. Paris, sorry, your time is
okay.
Up.
Okay. Well, all I'm saying is that as a city, as a person that has nothing else to stand, that you can tell people that we're doing a fairly decent job of addressing the issue here in the city of Tracy.
Thank you, Mr. Paris. Anyone else would like to make a public comment on this issue? Okay, what about on WebEx, Madam Clerk?
We have none on WebEx.
Okay, we're going to bring it back to the committee for discussion. Any further discussion?
Right. Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. I hear staff, I hear the residents in attendance today, even those who were not necessarily vocal, but you're here for a reason, right? This is an interest to be addressed in our community. My position is we have a long way to go. Especially when dealing with human behavior, there's nuances, as was stated by Mr. Paris. What we as a city can do and can put, in this case, all of our homeless eggs in one basket, is work on capacity and services so that we can return the parks for their intended use and connect our most vulnerable with the services that they need. I could continue to vent my frustrations, the frustrations of the residents, but I will save that and put my effort into building the rest of the phases of this homeless project. I support the progresses that have been made, and I really want to celebrate the successes on the city's end, TCCC's end, CityNet, all the community advocates who are involved in this process, everyone who showed up today. We're all here for the same reason. I don't think anyone is looking to delay this. And we're all here to get as clear information as possible. That being said, I do want to offer staff, the community, this community's full support in addressing the needs of all of our residents, including the most vulnerable of our unsheltered residents. Later on today, during committee items, I will be making a motion that I hope receives support to agendize a council discussion to change the Homeless Advisory Committee to meet monthly and to have staff provide weekly memo updates to the public on homeless services, including but not limited to construction. That's all my comments for now. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Bedoya. And I echo the sentiments of Councilmember Bedoya. We all want to see, we're all proud of the successes that we've shared and that we've worked to get to together thus far. And venting our frustrations, that's a normal part of, you know, the process for all of us, but we are very appreciative of all that has gone into the support that is for unhoused members of our community. At the same time, I do want to make sure that we acknowledge, you know, some of the challenges that we've had and how we can improve on those challenges by working with our community partners and, you know, and sharing where we think some of those vulnerabilities lie and how we can strengthen those vulnerabilities. Also by reaching out outside of the box, thinking outside of the box and going outside of our comfort zone, our city going out to Alameda, going out to Contra Costa, Stanislaus, and looking at communities where they have programs that work and possibly implementing some of those ideas here. And I see that we're doing that in some parts, some aspects. I also want to say that, you know, I want to acknowledge the residents who have made some, expressed some concerns about the warming center being at the park and some of the challenges to the students and the sports teams. And although they have moved, they moved reluctantly, and so I would hope that that's something that we consider should we find ourselves in this position again, having to have a warming center somewhere, that we not let that be at a park, but we look at other options that don't infringe upon the students and public's use of the parks, because right now we're trying to clear the parks. We don't want to spread things further out into more parks. But I do want to commend TCCC and CityNet, familiar faces, TPD, code enforcement, even trying security for the job that you do. I want to acknowledge you and thank you for all that you're all doing to support our efforts to get homeless housed in our community and give them the supportive services that they need. And I also already support that. We talked about it. And at this time, I have no further comment. And let me see what's next. I don't think there's anything. We're just going to accept the report. Did you want us to do a roll call, Madam Clerk? Or is it okay to just accept the report, Council?
Mayor Pro Tem, if you could do a roll call to make a motion to receive the report and then just do a roll call.
Okay, Tam, I'll entertain a
Move to accept the report.
Second. Madam Clerk, roll call, please.
Councilmember Bedoya?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Davis?
Yes. Okay, at this time, we're going to ask for any other public comments. I guess we've got a final public comment. Is there anybody who wishes to make a public comment about anything that wasn't on the agenda? Seeing none in the chamber, any on WebEx, Madam Clerk?
None on WebEx.
Okay, this time we're going to move to staff items. Staff, anything? Have anything?
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem, Councilmember Bedoya. We did want to make one announcement in response to some of the things we saw on social media yesterday. Out of an abundance of caution, Kimball High School was on lockdown. That was due to an support from Tracy PD to the U.S. Postal Service issuing a warrant to a neighborhood home close to Kimball High School. There was some discussion. It was impacting the sports complex and therefore drew some conclusions about the warming center and the homeless population there. I have confirmed with PD that was not at all related to why Kimball High School was on lockdown, and those incidents are completely unrelated. Again, it was out of an abundance of caution due to a warrant being issued to a person in the neighborhood behind Kimball High School.
Thank you for clarifying that, Ms. Snyder. Any more staff items? No, we're going to move on to committee items, and I'm prepared to support.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. I move to agendize a council discussion to change the Homeless Advisory Committee to meet monthly and to have staff provide weekly memo updates to the public on homeless services, including but not limited to construction.
Second. Madam Clerk, do I need to do anything with a roll call? Okay. All right. At this time, a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Second. Madam Clerk, roll call.
Councilmember Bedoya?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Davis?
Yes. That concludes the meeting.